most people do take life for granted, and until you're blindsided by the situation, you don't stop and think. You just never know what tomorrow may bring. I have mast cell activation disorder. Very rare disease. I have mast cells that are not functioning correctly. In my case, my body is basically treating everything as though it's an allergen, it's a foreign invader, it's like a threat to your body, and that creates these allergic responses. It's dangerous. It's not a good quality of life. Nothing has worked for me. I've been wanting to do a bone marrow transplant for years. I know the risks. Yes, there is a potential that I may not make it, because yes, death is one of the risks. But this is my only hope for a cure. This is my only hope to get better. This is my only hope to restore my life and to have a quality of life. Let's take the risk. Let's do this.
It's tough to watch. I mean, you see her today, and she seems somewhat healthy on the outside, but we've gone through it for 12 years, and that's really painful.
Do you remember when life was so simple, when everything was easy, back when you were little? Do you remember when you took your first steps, so many new beginnings? No, I will not forget. And
writing music can be therapeutic. I think any form, whether it be the songs that we're writing or a journal that I'm keeping, I think it helps a lot to write about the situation.
The music is a way of kind of speaking her mind, because she'll be writing all these lyrics about like her journey through the past 11, 12 years. Music has definitely brought us closer.
I definitely think that what we're doing together is a coping mechanism for everything they've gone through. Coming here is just kind of a release from everything that is presently their reality.
Music lets you break away from the normal, you know, lets you go to your own little world, I guess. Each different song, they all have like different meanings to them.
The songs that her and Sam and Robbie are putting out there, they're meaningful to us. It's what Tara's going through and we've gone through. But I think it's meaningful too, because other people could relate to it. People go through things in their lives that are something they have to overcome.
Sam singing these deep emotional songs is super unique. The majority of the content of what we write together does come from a really real place.
The earth for you. I know you're fighting hard. I
A lot of people, when they hear her sing and like when they see her, they'll think she's much older, but she's still a kid. She's only 13.
No, just stop.
Well, she started singing at age 4. She started with kids' versions of musicals. She was always, always singing.
Anything's possible.
Singing, dancing, that was Samantha. Both of my kids, thankfully, really loved playing instruments. Jared started playing the trumpet.
My brother got a trumpet for his birthday, and of course, you know, I saw him get something. I'm like, I have to have something too. But I didn't want to play the same instrument.
And she chose the saxophone.
When she was younger, she would always want to do things that I want to do, so she definitely gets irritating. I love her too, she's my sister. If that's what makes her happy, singing, then let her do it. Keep her on the right track.
Could this possibly be? Could you be just in time? Could this be my match? I hope you'll be my lifeline.
Cool, good, excellent. Yeah, really good. I think maybe put a little bit more like breath behind it. And also on lifeline. Let's see. Be my lifeline. Really kind of talk.
Lifeline.
Yeah, talk that ending.
Right. Starting this.
Yeah, because you have 4 songs. You have to do Friday nights.
It's amazing how powerful a song can be. Something that's not even tangible. You can't hold music. Right? It's just a sound. It's just a lyric, but the just the power and the meaning and the emotion and how universal and how people can connect with it. That's honestly one of the biggest parts why I do it.
We started working with Robbie.
We didn't dive into an original song right away.
Initially, Sam started working with him as one of her vocal coaches.
It's close. Get a little more power. Really support.
He has an in-home studio, so Sam records there.
When I first met Robbie, I was scared to move off of his couch. I did like not want to talk at all.
She didn't want to talk, she didn't want to sing for him, she didn't want to do anything.
I knew about Robbie from when he was on American Idol.
My name is Robbie Rosen, I'm 16, and I'm from Merrick, New York.
So why are you here? What's your story, man?
I was meant to do this. And I've been waiting to get onto this stage to sing to you since I was 7. I've watched every season, and I've always envisioned myself right here in front of all you guys.
Now I long for yesterday.
Wow.
He was one of the top 8 boy finalists.
I'm going to Hollywood, baby.
He's very well known in the school district, has performed a lot locally. He's definitely a household name. I certainly remember him being on American Idol.
Come back the next week. He cannot get me to stop talking.
Having Sam and Tara over, that's so joyous and just not just the music that we're coming up with, but just the time that we spend together is just so memorable and so, it's just amazing. We started working on a cover vocally.
And then he asked me if I wanted to sing for him, and I was so nervous.
From that first time when I heard her, her ear is so on point. She really hears harmony so easily, and especially at her age, it's just really, really impressive.
Cool, you got that full voice.
I just like have such a big passion for music.
You can hear when someone has a gift.
Chance.
Then we thought that it might be pretty incredible for us to start writing our own original songs based upon my health journey. I have a lot to share. I've had a lot of experiences. I'm battling a really long time. It was the three of us. It was Robbie, Samantha, and myself.
The process is very cool. The way that Sam has really brought these songs to life vocally and exuded that emotion and really felt what Tara was basically speaking through her lyric.
You
just have such an amazing passion for music and your craft, and that you really are here, and where you could be out having a great time with friends or doing whatever, and we only friends.
Yeah,
but seriously, you know, that you could be doing a million and one other things, you know, and you are here, you know, pursuing your passion, which is really inspiring and really awesome. So every song is different.
One led to two, and now we're up to seven.
Sometimes I'll work on the lyrics together here from scratch. Sometimes I'll just take them and refine them after they bring them to me.
I pray for more tomorrows, to see the sunset and the moon rise. I pray to watch the snow fall, to hear the rain pour from...
That's really what we focused on, was a lot of the health and really popular topics today, including bullying and gun violence.
We begin our program with Broken Heart in yet another American town.
We've written one song, Going Home, speaks about the Parkland, Florida shooting.
A 19-year-old who had purchased multiple weapons walked into his high school that he was expelled from and shot and killed 17 students and teachers.
Parkland consistently voted one of the safest communities in America until today.
It comes from the heartfelt condolences that we all gave to the Parkland victims. We really felt it close to home for me as an educator, and close to home for Tara as her sister's down there in Florida.
I feel like the lyrics are so powerful.
We're gonna stand up for what's right, and we're not gonna back down, and we're not gonna quit until we make a change.
Whether it's you or someone in your family or someone you're just close to, going through something like that, it's gonna be emotional for you.
It's a really heartfelt, you know, material that we hope that people can relate to.
And that was actually a collaboration between Sam, Robbie, and Javon, and he's a rap artist, and another being Mike, who is a producer. Hey, how are you?
Hey, technical difficulties, but I am here.
Good, thank you so much. Michael actually co-wrote with Robbie.
Robbie hit me up and was like, hey, I have a student and she wants to know if you could give her private lessons. Ruler? That's how I met Tara. I was asked to teach her.
I wanted to really take more of a formal songwriting class so I could learn. We spoke about song structure, learning really how to turn thoughts into song lyrics.
And so that's how it began.
We spend every week working together in a Skype session.
I would see her lyrics, she'd send them to me, and we'd be Skyping and the camera goes off, and I'm like, all right, let me check these lyrics out.
Do you have the newer lyrics that we wrote?
Wait, hang on.
When I saw her lyrics, I saw so much greatness, I saw raw talent, and I saw great ideas. And then it turned into, you know, can you help me write a song? And I was like, of course, of course.
We decided to write a song called Second Chance. So one night it was 4 something in the morning, and I actually looked at the clock and it was 4:18 a.m. And I opened up my nightstand drawer, trying to be as quiet as possible because I didn't want to wake Barry up. Pulled out a pen, and he turns around. He's like, is everything okay? And I went into my bathroom and turned on the light, took out a tissue box from the holder, and just started writing lyrics. That was really how Second Chance was born, and the first line starts off with, it's 4:18 a.m.
It's 4:18 a.m. in the stillness of the night. Thoughts swirling around inside my worn out mind.
There's hope finding your perfect bone marrow donor and getting a second chance at life.
I feel like it's always going to be my favorite. My favorite is Second Chance.
It was a really beautiful experience because it was like, imagine you create something and you really like it, right? You think it's really good, but then it goes on its way. And then comes back this amazing, amazing interpretation and creation and further development.
Second Chance, can't say more about that. It's exactly, you know, just defines what Tara is striving for right now in her battle.
Roberto, so I was thinking, since I broke your other ones, I could give you these if only you give me your old one signed.
I'm gonna try it right here. Ooh, that's gonna be really tough.
After I finished recording, I didn't notice the wire was stuck in like my shoe, and I started walking this way, and all of a sudden I feel like yank, and we hear something drop on the floor. And we look back, and these are laying there. We go to pick it up.
All good.
It's all good, though.
All good. Why don't you, we're gonna try. All right.
We're gonna try.
Pressure's on.
There we go.
We did do one piece called Carry On. Sam did not have input in those lyrics because that was a song that I wrote as a message to my children if things didn't go well and I didn't make it through the transplant. I wanted to give this to my children to let them know that no matter what, I'll always be a part of them, they'll always be a part of me, and that they're loved, and I'll be watching over them. And if this is goodbye, if this is our last day, carry on, carry on. Please don't be afraid. Carry on today.
The game? Oh God. Don't rip this one though, because this is a big one. It's a big one, Sam.
Take it, Dad.
Sometimes Sam and I will laugh late into the night and I get in trouble for it.
I'm gonna beat this kid.
Because everybody's trying to go to sleep and we're kind of the two that are up the latest. She's kind of a goofball, so.
Oh, Lord. Whatchamacallit came outside.
Can you stop talking? I'm trying to do my homework.
My mom is very caring and lovable, crazy, hardworking, very intelligent.
Even though she been dealing with a lot, she still like tries to give us the best we have to offer.
Well, me and my mom do a lot together. We go shopping together, although it never really goes that well, because she'll be like, gotta go, Sam, come on. But we do a lot together.
I always want to go to the happiest place on earth, which for me is Disney. I want to go to California, and I want to go to Aruba.
So you cannot two of them out by just going to California's Disney.
Yes, that's true.
Tara has a tough personality. Not tough as in, you know, mean, but just tough as she's a fighter.
My dad is very funny.
Very loving, a lot of passion.
Very handy, very helpful.
He's very hardworking.
He usually puts others before himself. It could be like midnight and I could be panicking over a test, and even though he has to be up at like 6 o'clock the next day, he'll stay up and he'll help me. No matter how tired he knows he's gonna be the next day, he'll just always be there.
And then I have to write another English essay.
I think Jared is more a little bit like me. That's my personality too. I'm a little bit more laid back.
When I was growing up, my brother was always very protective of me. He would always be like watching over me, like always being there. Kind of like my best friend, like my older best friend.
She's
literally on the last thing.
Finish it, please.
Is it choice?
Still think you're doing it backwards?
We'll find out in a second, Jared.
Sam is very energetic, full of life, and is always bouncing around and going from one thing to the next, to the next, to the next, to the next.
I love you so, oh, I never let you.
My sister is very energetic. She loves to always be involved in things. She plays softball, she plays the saxophone, she used to dance.
But there's a side of her now that is a true teenager, very much attached to her phone and Snapchat and Instagram and those types of typical teenage things. But she's also very serious because she's a really, really, really dedicated and motivated student. She's in all honors classes as an eighth grader. She's taking 2 ninth grade courses as an eighth grader. And if Sam gets below a 95, she's upset. So she's very, very hardworking.
My parents are definitely loving. They can be a little strict sometimes, but all parents are.
Barry and I actually met on a singles weekend back in 1989.
I don't remember how she'll be able to tell you.
And that was it. We started dating.
She's intelligent. She's pretty. I thought she'd be a good wife and a good mother. I thought she had a head on straight, which was important to me.
He's just a great, great guy and extremely good looking. I have to have that in.
Entire life, my mom has been ill, so I don't really have any memories of me with her, without her being ill and going through what she has to go through. At all the birthday parties I would always go to, you know, all the moms would like always stay, and then I would be the kid with my dad there, which I didn't mind, but I'd be like, where's my mom? And she would usually be in the hospital.
I've like adapted to, like, I used to, her being ill kind of like became a part of our lives.
What I really remember from my childhood is every single day the ambulances would be at my house.
One night I was in my room and she was getting sick, so my dad had to call the ambulance, and I remember looking out my window and just seeing a bunch of cop cars pull up and she was screaming, you know, it was scary.
We would just always have to be prepared because it was really every single day she was going to the hospital.
My mom taught me like how to call 911 when I was very young.
They had to tell me when I was younger that an ambulance was an amusement park ride, because I would always see my mom going out in the stretcher and I would be like, I want to go. And my dad would have to tell me that it was a roller coaster ride.
Still not used to it because anything could happen. You never know.
To see this and to be part of this and being helpless, not be able to do anything, it's just, you know, it just takes a toll on you. Day by day by day, you know, it's just, man, you know, I just remember at the beginning, it was very, very difficult.
March 31st of 2006, I had woken up and I found hundreds of strands of hair on my pillowcase. I went into the shower to start washing my hair and clumps were just falling out.
She was telling me my hair was falling out. At first I thought she was just, you know, a couple of hairs and such, and then I saw that it was very real.
Despite the fact that all that was happening, I still went to work. I work as a special education teacher, and as the day progressed, there was just more and more hair all over my jacket, all over my sweater, so I knew something was not right. And I had called my dermatology office. They agreed to see me that Sunday. And by that Sunday, I had lost all of my hair.
Within 5 days, she was bald from head to toe. So at that point, we obviously knew there was something terribly wrong with my sister.
She calls and we're on the phone. She says, "You're not going to believe it. I lost all my hair." I said, "Oh, she's probably exaggerating, you know." And I came up and she did lose all her hair.
I was like shocked when I saw my daughter. She had absolutely no hair.
And immediately began taking her to doctors and trying to figure out what went wrong.
You know, you just don't know what to do.
Strange things were starting to happen, like on a daily basis. I remember one day I was driving, and honestly, I'm lucky to like be alive because I think I actually blacked out for a couple of seconds while I was driving. And I remember a truck in front of me, and I hit the brakes, like came to, and of course got off of the highway, pulled into a parking lot, and I called 911. They took me to the hospital. They thought I was having a heart attack because my heart rate was extremely fast and my blood pressure was really elevated. They keep you there, they observe you, and they discharge you because they can't really find what's really causing all of this. They don't know yet what's going on.
My most vivid memory is when we were all at the house one night. My daughter, Rachel, and I flew in, and we were all at the house. Samantha was there, Jared was there, my parents were there. And Tara got very sick, and she started to go into anaphylactic shock in front of us. And everybody sort of panicked, and I was like, "Stop. You know, get me a bag. Just get me a bag," because she was hyperventilating. My mother handed me a plastic bag. And I'm like, "No, I need a paper bag. She needs a paper bag to breathe into." So we finally got her a paper bag to breathe into, and EMS responded shortly thereafter.
I went to the city to see different specialists. So I was seen by an endocrinologist, a cardiologist, rheumatologist, neurologist, dermatologist, pulmonologist, hematology, oncology.
Honestly, hundreds of different doctors.
So I was a patient at NYU, at Columbia, Cornell Weill, New York Presbyterian, the National Institutes of Health, Johns Hopkins.
We traveled all over the country. We took her, my mom and I, flew her over to the Mayo Clinic. And I believe they came back and said she was depressed or something. That was a very difficult flight for us.
I had a really bad reaction. I just started to go into one of these episodes, and there was a nurse on board. They had to lay me down in the aisle throughout the entire flight. She kept saying that my pulse was very thready. I think it was down to like 50.
We had to have an emergency landing. We were greeted by EMS.
Paramedics came on board. They took me off. They stabilized me.
It was very scary.
Have not been on a flight since.
The trips were just, at that point in time, they were terrible.
One doctor thought I had Lyme disease, so they treated me very aggressively with IV doxycycline for Lyme disease. I wound up having a radical thymectomy. That was no solution, and we started with massive amounts of different drugs. I was on steroids, cyclosporin, Plaquenil, Cellcept, Cytoxan, cyclophosphamide, methotrexate, Sprycel, tofacitinib, subcutaneous and intravenous IVIG treatments. I had a stem cell transplant, so they tried all of these. Nothing really worked.
I just remember being so sick that she couldn't even walk.
Watching my sister literally deteriorate in front of my eyes. I mean, she weighed maybe 90-something pounds at one point.
When I was on the feeding tube, I was 98 pounds. I had lost 50% of my muscle mass. I was literally skin and bones. I mean, you could just see down my back, my spine protruding. You could see my collarbone. It was almost like, how do I explain it? Like my body was eating itself, almost like.
She was dying. She was all skin and bones.
It's really so hard. And unless you're in that position, you really don't know what it's like. There were times that we'd be going to the house on the Meadowbrook Parkway and the ambulance would be going the opposite direction. Yeah. Tara was in it.
There were points where my doctors thought, not gonna make it. You tell your kids all the time how much you love them and just to be good and do their best and try their hardest. And I would tell Jared to make sure he looks after Sam and to take good care of her because he was the big brother. Be good for daddy and be good for your grandparents and, you know, treat each other good and take care of each other.
It's been like a nightmare.
I was up at Brigham and Women's in Chestnut Hill, Massachusetts. I was seen by a doctor that specializes in mast cell disease. The doctor walked into the examining room and we talked about the symptoms. I was diagnosed with mast cell disease right then and there within, gonna say maybe an hour. My case with mast cell activation disorder, I have mast cells that are not functioning correctly, behaving improperly. I remember asking the doctor whether or not it was an April Fool's joke because it was April 1st that day, and I had at that point, you know, been diagnosed with so many different things and treated for so many different things.
By that time, anything that anybody said to me, I was very skeptical on anyhow, because we've had so many different diagnoses and none of them were correct. So when they said that, I didn't get my hopes up high, but we went through the process and the medications that they prescribed for Tara actually did relieve maybe the severity of what she was going through.
She started me on a very aggressive treatment plan, like immediately. I started responding and I was able to gain weight back and I was able to gain muscle mass back and I was able to gain strength back. So we knew the diagnosis was correct. I have tested allergic to almost everything. There are so many things that set off reactions. So for me, high histamine foods, so chocolate, eggplant, tomatoes, tomato sauce, ketchup, environmental allergens, pet dander, perfumes, cleaning products, soap products, fabric softeners or laundry detergents, scented candles, incense, altitude changes, sunlight, temperature changes to barometric pressure changes. I mean, that is literally dangerous for me.
And she could have a reaction just by smelling a flower and, you know, I can't tell you a list on my board of flowers because it could set her off.
No flowers for me from my husband on Valentine's Day. Mm-mm. If I was not diagnosed, I would not be here talking to you today. No way, no how.
It's tough because I don't really show emotions in front of the kids. I think it's difficult for Sam and Jared. I don't know how difficult it is. We try to make it as normal for them as possible. It could be a whole lot worse if they didn't have a mother or didn't have a father, I would think, because I've been there. My father passed away when I was 10. Unfortunately, he had a heart attack. He was in his mid-40s. I didn't have really a chance to say my goodbyes, obviously. Not knowing as a child at that age really anything about death or life. It's a long time that they had to deal with this, but I don't think they know any different. I recall one situation where a kid from the neighborhood, I think it was Halloween, and they knocked on the door, probably like 10 or 11, and I think he was making fun of my wife and calling her a freak.
Which really got me upset. I came home crying.
I actually went to the kid's house and told his parents and, you know, explained to them that when people are different and sick, it's probably not a great idea to make fun of them. Because it affected my son.
The father actually came back here and had the kid come and say sorry to my mom. And I guess he realized what he did wrong because when he saw her, he was like very upset. And you could tell that he felt bad.
I became very ill when my son was very young. He was a kindergartner, and for years, we had to pay for private school bus transportation, which was phenomenally expensive. And at first it was one child, then it became two children. We are not zoned for school bus transportation through my school district because we live too close to the zoned school that my children attend. And I was too sick to either drive my children or walk my children to school every day to ensure their safety. I brought my story to my senator and I shared my thoughts, and he sponsored a bill which would consider providing school bus transportation for children who had either sick parents or guardians who were not able to drive or walk them to school to ensure their safety. The bill has been around since 2011. It went through multiple amendments, and it is currently sponsored by Senator Brooks.
She had a unique situation in that it wasn't the student that had the disability, but it was the parent. But it was beyond the transportation guidelines for the state, so what do we do? To me, it's logical that we change the rule to recognize when the parent or the guardian has a disability that makes it not possible for them to provide the transportation, that we should have the obligation to do that.
We're still working on trying to get it passed. I am working with a lobbying firm up at Albany that I'm very proud to say has been lobbying on my behalf for the last three legislative sessions, and they have been doing it all pro bono. I thought it was really, really essential for certain families. My daughter underwent a tremendous, tremendous amount of bullying, especially during sixth grade. For two solid years, it was relentless. We were constantly up at the school, constantly sending emails, writing letters, reaching out to the principal, the AP, the school psychologist, the social worker. It just never stopped. Sam really, really was impacted and affected by it. There were days that she didn't even want to go to school. And, you know, I really had to be very encouraging and just kind of let her know that you can't be bothered by this and you need to rise above it. Because of all the bullying that went on with Samantha for years, what we did was we wrote a song about bullying, and the title of that song is Sticks and Stones, and that's how that song came to be, was a result of all of the bullying that she endured over the years.
I was born to be a fighter. You can throw sticks and stones.
Oh,
They played this demo and I just flipped. It just spoke to me in ways that, you know, when you're thinking about wanting to work with an artist in any capacity and help them along, that song really sort of connected with me on many levels. Lyrically, it really, it was well mature beyond the years of something that you would hear from a 13-year-old. And I remember I heard that song once, and I hadn't heard it again for maybe a period of 6 more weeks. They went into the studio and they did some additional recording to fully produce the song, and it was still in my head. And when they had the finished version of the song, they sent it to me and said, I still remember the song from hearing it once. And then I proceeded to, I have a 4-year-old daughter, and I played the song for her. And after a couple of listens, she had it memorized and she's singing it in the house. And one thing led to another, and we continued a dialogue about working together and helping her out in some capacity.
I haven't gotten any critical feedback, like anything that you want to change.
I think he sent few things. Yeah, that was it.
Okay.
We just kind of said whatever.
Okay.
I think that they're great.
Okay.
Like, the more I listen to them, the more I love them.
Okay. Yeah. She'll knock them out. You play a couple of those tunes for people though, right?
What?
For your friends?
Yeah. Roberto likes all of them. So. I mean, that's the only friend I really talk.
She says that that's her only friend is Robbie.
What about your brother?
No, he doesn't listen to any of it.
He hasn't heard any of it yet?
He's heard it, he doesn't.
Yeah. He's not dialed in.
He's into rap.
Okay, well, we got a rap song now.
Mm-hmm.
How cute! Oh my gosh, I'm
little variety
so,
box.
Yes, I'm so excited. That's like what I'm looking forward to. The cookie dough!
The little things in life.
God, I'm so, the last time I had this was like a couple months ago.
Come in.
We're one of the oldest studios in Manhattan. The roster of artists who've come through here is truly legendary. It doesn't matter who you are, if you're Mariah Carey, Neo, who's been here, or the first time you've ever been in a studio. We really believe that it's all about good vibes.
First time I came to the city to record. Pretty excited. And it's like, I'm like in New York City, so like it's even cooler.
First time that we all met Mike in person. Other than that, I was strictly doing Skype sessions with him. Just an all-around great guy. My nickname for him is Mr. Kindness, and I call him my lyrical soulmate, another nickname for him. Mike definitely gives off positive vibes. He tries to find the good in everything.
You put music out there, and the love comes back in ways, and I think that's what Tara and Sam have done and are created, and the way that they've pulled all of us into their lives.
Surprise! What is your mom? There you go. You have a lot in here. Let's see what you got. Wow. So what exactly is this?
It's cookie dough.
Oh, interesting.
Oh my god, I think I just cut my lip like from being so excited and running in here.
Are you okay? Mm-hmm. This is like a serious concoction.
Sorry, got a little excited over there, guys.
Excitement is okay.
Sam, take your picture.
I will.
You're not even gonna eat it.
And you know what else?
Wait, I just want to see what's in here. Oh my god, these are too cute. My god, look how tiny it is.
No.
Oh my god, and it comes with mini spoons. Can my day get better, honestly?
Yes. Yeah, the piano, for some reason,
okay.
The piano,
everyone can have
audio or data file.
This one. I thought it would be nice to share.
And I'm gonna try it after, trust me.
You know what I'm
saying.
Have a mix, and then if we have to go back to do a mix with the individual music tracks, we can do that too. Mm. But at least we'll be able to get, you know, a really nice version of it.
So good. I'm gonna have him.
So, knowing what Tara and Sam have been going through, there's almost this duality of a woman who's been challenged on one level with her health, but she also has this strength. And I find that that's where the convergence of her music is. There's a fragility, but there's also a great strength. And I think that's what truth is. A bunch of people all in a room to help channel a message of love and hope, and everyone coming together to try to get to the pinnacle of what the potential of that can be, vocally, musically, mixing. And that's why it takes so many people, from Terry believing and Tara cheering on Sam, and Fran is a two-time Grammy Award-winning producer who's helping to make sure sonically everything is so on point. You can throw sticks and stones. I'll be ready, I'll be ready. You should know your words are cold.
Anybody that we're working with at this point is just phenomenal. They're just all wonderful, marvelous, fantastic people.
When you surround yourself with collaborators that believe in her, we allow her the opportunity to grow and make mistakes, and it doesn't have to be perfect all the time, and to continue to sort of grow as an artist, as a performer, as a songwriter.
Do you remember when life was so simple, when everything was easy, back when you were little? Do you remember when you took your first steps? So many new beginnings. No, I will not forget.
Cool, sounded really good. Really good. How's the vocal mix for yourself? You sound, it's comfortable
for
you?
Yeah.
Cool, let's take one more. Maybe this time just kind of like, just sit back just a little bit more, relax.
Do you remember when you took your first steps? So many new beginnings. No, I will not forget.
It was very cool, and it was a very fun experience being in the studio.
Social Studies Friday, Science Friday, Spanish Friday, English Friday. Just reminded myself I have 4 tests on Friday and a lot of homework.
I've come so far since like last year. Like, who would have thought that that's like my voice?
Thank you.
I'm really proud of like how far I've come with my voice.
Wow. Sound amazing.
With all of this music that has entered our lives, I'm probably at one of the happiest points in my life. It just has brought so much joy for all of us.
She really gave me the clarity in life to stay strong in the face of adversity, to put a smile on, and in short, just to keep it real. I've been so thankful for her just straight up outlook on life. And so often when some things have come against me, I would call them challenges, she's really helped me in ways that she doesn't know to accept them and to keep them in perspective.
Wait, ready?
I feel like we all needed a onesie.
We should get matching onesies.
Like our studio.
Studio onesies.
And me and Fran are in onesies.
We should do custom ones on the back. It should say Team Rise.
Team Rise, there you
right?
go.
I love it.
You could put it in your point of view of if you're going through something, like whether it be like a relationship or like loss of a family member, like a friend or an illness, you could put it as how you want to see it and how you need to see it.
Chickadee.
Mm-hmm. I'd circulate it, Sticks and Stones, to about a half dozen of my friends in the industry that have worked in A&R for major labels and major publishing companies. And all of them believe that that song has potential to be a huge hit. So it was some validation, you know, you're always in this industry, always looking for some sort of validation that you're on the right track.
Yep. Great to work with you.
Thank you for the job. Love it. Did great. I'm excited. Sounds so good.
The purpose is really to hopefully share this music and these songs with, I'm going to make it very grand, with the world. You're here, but yet you can't live your life the way that you want to live it, the way that you envisioned it. I still try to enjoy each and every day. Just be thankful and grateful for what we do have. There were certainly dark, dismal times when you often questioned whether or not you were going to make it through the next day or make it through the night. I hope I'll be here to see my children grow even more and both of them to become college graduates and get on with their careers and get married and start a family and have the opportunity to be a grandparent. So I'm hoping for all of that.
She's at a point where she's lived with us for 12 years, kind of held in check by all the drugs, but all the drugs have an effect on you as well.
You just can't keep taking all of these medications for years and years and years and years and years. Eventually, they're gonna have an impact on different organs. Ultimately, these drugs are gonna take its toll. At this point, there are no other alternatives for me. There's no more medication that I could try, and I certainly can't continue to live this way because ultimately this disease will kill me.
When she goes in for the bone marrow, I have concerns because I don't know what shape she's going to be in. If she does heal from the bone marrow, because remember, it's somebody else's bone marrow that will be replacing her immune system, I know she's going to suffer. And so that obviously bothers me.
Whatever you choose, we're with you 100%.
We all know that it's very dangerous. You all know the risk. well, you know the risk, but anything could really happen. Like, she could potentially pass away from this. As I know and believe, she'll be back here soon, so I definitely cherish even like little things like her, even her yelling at me sometimes, you know.
It's a little nerve-wracking having her leave us for 3 months, but I know that in the end, it's all gonna be okay because I know that it's what she wants, and she's wanted it for a long time.
In the back of my head, there's that fear. You know, will she be okay? Is this the perfect match for my sister? So it's a scary moment.
With my husband, I always told him that if I were to die, I always felt he should get remarried.
You take an oath because, you know, that's what marriage should be. You're supposed to be there for people. I'm hoping that this is going to work for her. And I'm hoping for her sake, she'll be able to live a little bit more of a normal life. And my kids will have a mother that they could still spend time with, and not at a hospital. And I'll have a wife that I could hopefully enjoy life with.
I have to be confident, I have to be optimistic, I have to think positive, have to have all those good vibes and positive thoughts, because that's a huge part of succeeding and making it. Because if you walk in there with negative thoughts and think that you're not gonna make it, you're not gonna survive, I honestly think you're dead. You're not gonna make it.
You like to go into these things with data. These are the results, this is what we're gonna do, this is how other people have behaved. And go to the medical literature and put mast cell activation disorder and transplant. And there's only two reports of two patients, and one of them is not a very detailed report. And the other one, it just says the symptoms came back. So there's not a lot of, you know, things that I can hang my hat on. This is more like launching the space shuttle or like launching a rocket for the first time. You know it was going to go up, but you didn't know how it was going to come down.
The success behind this has really never been quantified. Frustration number one is who's doing research on it. And the problem with that is probably nobody, because there's such a small sampling of patients.
I felt that this was a situation in which transplant could potentially help. That although there wasn't a lot of evidence or data out there because of the rareness of the disorder, that it was ethical to proceed to the treatment as long as she was informed of all the risks. She studied this disease carefully. She's the world's expert in her disease. Nobody knows Tara's mast cell activation disorder as well as Tara does. And I think she came to the conclusion that the only way this was going to get better was to get rid of her mast cells. And, you know, eventually she convinced me of it too, and we're in that journey now. And I hope we're right.
We knew that it was in the millions of dollars for the procedure.
Most of the cost of my bone marrow transplant will be covered by my health insurance.
It is a decision which has not been made lightly.
They want to completely knock out my immune system. And I'm gonna be pretty sick from what I understand.
We had long conversations about all the side effects and all the risks. And she still was adamant that, and as she put it, she did not think that she could live any longer the way she was living.
I know that my donor he's a 35-year-old male. That's all I am allowed to know about my donor. And he's going to give me a new, healthy immune system that will properly function.
If it is a success, if like, you know, 3 years from now, 5 years from now, Tara and I are hitting high fives and she feels her quality of life has improved dramatically, I will feel satisfied and elated as an individual, and as a physician, because at the end of the day, our goal is not to make people live forever, but to give people the longest life with the best quality of life possible, with the minimum amount of interventions.
Do you remember when life was so simple, when everything was easy, back when you were little? Do you remember when you took your first steps, so many new beginnings?
I had expressed to my family that before I went in for my bone marrow transplant, I really wanted to spend time with my close family members and very close friends.
It was great to see everyone like come together for my mom. The dinner was kind of like a farewell dinner to bring all our friends together, like for one last time to like see everyone.
It wound up to be an intimate group of 58 people that were in attendance to spend time, and I thanked a lot of people and let them know how meaningful they all are to me and how much I love and adore a lot of people. You could just feel the love in the room the entire night.
Just be there, and love them and cherish them, enjoy every single moment with them. Because you never know what life brings, really. You never know what life brings.
We've definitely rallied as a family, and we've been there to support each other throughout this definitely trying time. There's a genuine bond between all of us, which is so important. This is always my saying, this too shall pass. When things are tough, we had him add a little bird from my sister, which is her middle name, Tara Dove, because this too shall pass, and she's gonna be fine.
My family and I were all very happy for her, but at the same time, we're gonna miss her and spending time with her and her laughs and smiles and hugs. But we know that in the end, we're all gonna be happy because she's gonna be happy.
She won't be there for my graduation, but she'll be there in spirit, you know?
If it works, it's great. I'll be very happy. There's always the back of my mind that if, you know, if she's in a worse situation, then, you know, obviously it's something that we all don't want.
She is going to come through that with flying colors. She's going to recover. She's going to recuperate. She's going to recover to 100%. And when she does, Tara and I are going away on vacation. Barry could come if he wants, but I think it'll just be Tara and I.
Well, definitely one of those trips I'll be on it, I'm sure. I can envision that. I want to eat with her. I think she could be a really good eater. So I definitely want to sit down and have like a good meal with her without her having to worry about, oh, this I can't eat, this I can't eat. So yeah, we're going to eat. We're definitely going to eat.
Hi, Ellen. Tara and I have talked about, you know, taking that girl's trip when she's up to it, and hopefully just kind of doing all those quote unquote like normal things, you know, being able to, you know, meet for lunch, meet for, you know, to go out, and it not being this, you know, kind of huge thing for her.
Alrighty, so I promise no sappy speeches tonight, and hopefully not even one teardrop. As you know, I've honestly cried gallons of silent tears over the years. It has not been easy. With the exception of just a few, all of you know my story and have walked the walk with me in different capacities over the last 12 years. You know that I'm extremely grateful for everything you've done and that I love you all to pieces. You have all touched my heart in your own unique and very special way. Only the good die young, and I'm sometimes bad to the bone, depending on who you ask, so I will do this, come back stronger than ever, and live a very long and healthy life. Years ago, I was given this dove necklace that I wear around my neck. When I received it, my step-niece said to me, "Don't worry, Aunt Tassie. One day, you will be set free." With the exception of my stem cell transplant, a few procedures, and a very few special occasions, I have rarely taken it off. Tonight, I take off this necklace, if I could get it off, because I know that my donor will soon set me free from mast cell disease. I'm going to ask Sammy and Robbie to keep it safe for me over the next few months so I could return to a place I never knew I was meant to be, because there is no doubt I'm coming home. Please keep all of your prayers, your support, your positive energy, your good vibes, and of course, your love coming my way.
We are driving on the Grand Central Parkway headed to Memorial Sloan to get checked in to begin process for what I'm hoping is going to be an incredible journey. So again, I hope you're ready for me, Mr. Anonymous Donor, because I'm ready for you.
I will be in an isolation room. The first 10 days, the conditioning regimen is going to be very intense. I'm going to be on 3 different chemo drugs for the first 9 days. It's anticipated I'm going to be really, really, really sick. And then on day 10, I'll receive my transplant.
Here's your donor.
Yep.
Are you ready?
I am so ready.
Okay.
Yep. If you don't accept the donor cells and you develop graft versus host disease, there's the possibility that the graft versus host disease could be worse than the actual disease that I'm battling. With transplant, generally, the first 100 days are critical. I really try to keep my focus on doing this, getting through it, and just hoping for a cure.
Every 30 minutes.
So
now, dim the lights. I need everybody to take out their phones. Shine them bright. Wave them all in the air. Wave them all like you just don't care. Because here is to my second chance.
Stillness of the night, thoughts swirling around inside my worn out mind. Could this possibly be Could you be just in time? Could this be my match? I hope you'll be my lifeline. I pray for more tomorrows, to see the sunset and the moon rise. I pray to watch the snow fall, to hear the rain pour from the sky. My living, a dying wish is for a second chance. A second chance at living, a second chance to laugh. Life. You want nothing more than to live when you've been dying. Could my prayers be answered? Could these wrongs become right? Could this be my freedom? Set me free from this crime. I pray for more tomorrows, to see the sunset and the moon rise. I pray to watch the snow fall, to hear the rain.
Time, 2.5 months away from home, and they finally let me go home today, day 60 post-transplant. So I'm happy to be home. It's good to be home.
It's not been an easy process. She had a major mast cell attack, low blood pressure, tachycardia. I mean, it was scary. Her immune system is still a tenth of what it should be.
If I am cured or in some type of remission, so to speak, we are going to take a family vacation. Thank you.